here that this is a little dictation about abortion is being pushed so heavily by people these days, and ignorant women who say it's their right to choose. It is not your right to kill anybody. So here I go. I think everyone will be as distressed as I have been by the dictation that followed the prophecy given in 1975, that if the current free and easy attitude to this infanticide, for that is what it is allowed to continue, we would see a great increase in children born with all sorts of deformities, both mental and physical. And at the time of writing, that prophecy has not only come true, but is steadily becoming more a common occurrence. Now we're having people who have four children, they've all got some form of autism. More recently, there has been much media time given to the suffering of girls who have had their pregnancy terminated with medication, as opposed to the former termination performed under anaesthetic. Girls who reported hemorrhaging and aborting in public places, or passing out alone in their flats, let alone the mental suffering of these girls, which is rarely addressed. Girls who have had sex with a man or several men who have no interest in any child that they might have created, and even less concern or interest in the girl they have created this child with. Many of these girls damage not only their physical bodies, but also suffer with terrible depression after going through an abortion. One psychiatrist who I heard talking on Radio 4 some years ago said that in his experience, around 70% of girls became vegan or developed some other seriously restrictive dietary abnormality within a year of their termination. One might ask why these girls are putting themselves through such suffering for a man or men who do not care about them. Also, why are doctors using these chemical abortions, knowing that many girls are having some terrible experiences with them? One very dear and concerned male gynaecologist said that the simple answer was that no doctor who had taken the Hippocratic oath to preserve life wherever possible went into the medical profession to terminate it. Last year, which was 2019, it was stated in the media that 60% of all conceptions ended in termination in this country, and only about 30% were performed before the 12-14 week stage had been reached. What are we coming to? This fate could be what is in store for all of us if this knowledge is not given to us. This is the dictation again. The writer's attention has been drawn to a statistic of 160,000 abortions performed in this last year. This is my mother's original dictation. Of 1975-1976. Possibly in the years of 1976 and all the years following it, a similar number will be performed. Anyone who has a small ability in arithmetic can work out these numbers for themselves. Let it be understood that out of the number of 160,000, possibly 100,000 can be considered to have been thus murdered, for this is what these figures must represent in human life. And all will have been harmed by this in some way, and many of them must be reborn as malformed or deformed or autistic children in a subsequent life. Some are never the same. Just as there are those here who care for the sick and have knowledge of physical ills, so there are also those who have deep knowledge of all the spiritual sicknesses and how to nurse back to spiritual health the afflicted who have come to them suddenly and violently from the physical world. Aborted babies very often come into this category. Often they do it with music. That is one of the very important things they use. Procreation works in such a way, like a computer, that if the correct set of human genes are fused together during intercourse or physical union between two persons, then the corresponding human souls, perhaps not really destined to be born at that time, must be quickly prepared for life and born into that body. If that body forming on the inside the mother is allowed to progress to the quickening, or 12-14 week stage, and then is suddenly destroyed, this spiritual entity or soul will have been through a very disturbing experience and must be carefully nursed back to spiritual health before it can resume its place in the rest planes from whence it came. However, the kind of evil men who commit rape upon an innocent victim and whose progeny are not destroyed sometimes release other evil people into the world, souls imprisoned for the sake of others, just as they are here in the physical world, until they can be sufficiently corrected for release. Such physical lives should always be terminated for the sake of others. I've got my comment here. This is from a later source and gives more information on what happens to the spirit of those who suffer a late termination. I feel that so many girls are being sucked into free and easy attitude to sex that prevails at the present moment, and many find themselves in the predicament of being pregnant by a young man who has no care for them or their unborn child. The girl feeling that she cannot cope the responsibility alone and possibly without her parents' support delays well past the 12 to 14 week stage when the entity has been placed in the tiny body within her, and then finally takes the decision to terminate the pregnancy without knowing the harm she is doing to her child. After all, this knowledge has never been given to us before, and the workings of reincarnation are a closed book to us. And this is the dictation. For the first time in living history now in your modern world, everyone is accepting that the mother of an unborn child must have the right to decide whether her child shall live or not. It has been decided in England by several important court cases that the father has no right in this direction. It is the body of the female that is most concerned, and she alone who is giving life, and if she so wills it, to destroy it. Abortion is not new. Girls in the distant past and not so distant past have often destroyed themselves as well in an effort to rid themselves of a child they no longer want. Almost always, the most civilized and intelligent people become, the less they seem to want children and the trouble of rearing them. It is the greatest pity that there are not more white women who have the simple, gentle love for their children shown by so many ignorant tribal people who live in the direst poverty in the wildest parts of this planet. The lack of children born in the West is leading us towards a situation where the most important thing that promotes human happiness is fast disappearing in the Western world, and that is large and strong family clans. Apparently many black people in Africa, you know, if they don't come here thinking they're going to have a better life, they have large family clans. And there was a girl who came to me when I was working in Covent Garden with her child. The father had obviously disappeared, and she was obviously living in a council flat and had, you know, she was living on benefit. And she came worried about her stretch marks. And I remember I said to her after a while, I said, look, this isn't about your stretch marks, is it? I said, I said, it's very hard bringing up a child on your own. And if you were in your own country, your mother would help you, your sisters, your aunt, your granny, you know, you would be surrounded by your own clan who would help you. And you wouldn't have the responsibility of bringing up this child completely alone and on, you know, very little money. Anyway, she went out much happier. And she came back a year later, heavily pregnant, with her partner, who was a jazz musician. And her little boy was still in the thing. And they were going back to Africa. So I felt I'd helped her. And I hope, she's probably had about six other children now, but anyway, I hope she's happy. Right. In the physical world, people are really blind to the truth about creation and how it all happens. Everyone knows that first some sort of mating must take place, whether it be for lowly animals or higher animals, or for the highest of all, mankind himself, who is only the ultimate animal, and this truth must be understood and accepted. After death, mankind does not become divine, never. Firstly, everyone must come to know that all creation of living creatures and plants as well can only take place in the living physical world by the fusion of male and female cells. The various processes for these fusions are very simple for even a child to understand, but difficult for the very young to accept, as it applies to themselves and their beloved parents. Today the concept of the stalk and the gooseberry bush has almost disappeared, thanks to the explicit and sometimes terrible films that even young children are subjected to constantly. That is if their parents do not protect them from it. Secondly, let it be understood that all creation, even the planets themselves, exist on two structures at once, and both can be destroyed and reduced to an infinitesimal speck, too small to be seen, even on the strongest microscope. The tiny seed that creates humanity, both male and female, and which is carried in the young adult bodies, is very much more complicated and difficult to understand than even the most highly experienced and clever scientists or biologists could possibly comprehend. All those who are Christians and Buddhist and many, many other types of belief are firmly convinced that there is life after death, life in paradise or several planes of paradise, and that once their physical bodies die, they rise up to a new life. If there were only one body, whatever sort of body do those who have such beliefs imagine they would inhabit? Is life after death a sort of cloudy existence, with those who live there floating around like some sort of gas? This would be impossible if anybody thinks sensibly about such a thing, and very distressing for anyone forced to live in such a body. This book is being dictated to the writer by those of us who are determined that the living shall have the whole truth about all those questions that everyone asks, and for which so far there has never been any proper logical answer. As we have said at the beginning, all those things that you need to know are simple and logical. Such mysteries as there are, you need to have no knowledge of here. Some mysteries are so complicated that no one really knows the answer. Everything on both structures exists by various powers of electricity, and not simply the same sort as that which powers an electric bulb or an electric motor, as you now have in your modern world. The human body and its counterpart on our structure, the life after death body, if you like, looks much the same and is powered the same. Once the tiny male sperm unites with the female ovum in human beings of all colours and types, the process of creation begins and the physical body starts to form. The male sperm is powered by electricity, and every single sperm from any male body is an exact copy of the person in whose body it is housed. If he has a long thin nose, tall thin limbs and a tendency to thinness, then that instruction will be fed into the female ovum. As each tiny sperm is an amazingly complex and powerful computer, everyone will ask, how is it then that every family where there is more than one child from the same parents, that no two brothers and sisters are ever the same, either in looks, thought or speech? They are all different. Everyone knows that there are two types of male sperm, those that create male children and those that create female children. It is not known that there are also within the female ovary various different characterizations that will create male offspring, or more readily female offspring, usually on alternate months. However, some women create more female ovum than male, and they do not always create them in exactly the same sequence. Very much of the exact mechanics of birth are a mystery, an amazing, wonderful mystery. In the very beginning, until what is known as the quickening, when the child starts to move about inside the womb, there is no other body forming, and there is therefore no person or spiritual entity within the forming embryo. Quickening or movement is the sign, that is to say, not revolving around in a haphazard way, but real movement of limbs, the sign that the person is beginning to develop. So when the little body is about 2 inches long and is a complete human body, that's about 12 to 14 weeks, that's when they put the entity in. Where has this person come from, people might ask. Hopefully this will be explained in the dictation on reincarnation, which at present no one understands, let alone believes in. Imagine that someone has died, leaving his or her physical body. They arrive on the other side, where we who are dictating this chapter and the book live in some magical way that we do not understand. Once the soul or entity is placed within the embryo, it forms our earthly body and the after-death or spiritual body, and it is in this body that we exist after we die. Firstly, the deceased person will be taken into some sort of hospital or reception centre, where skilled technicians, just as you have them in the living world, but much more knowledgeable, will carefully examine the newly arrived body to see if it is fit and well enough for the person inside it to take up his or her place in the rest planes. If the body is very badly damaged, then the body must be destroyed electrically and the person placed in storage until some sort of life can be found for them. The well-being of the physical body does have its effect on the spiritual body, if you like to call it that, which when separated from its host, decaying body, neither needs to eat, excrete or procreate, as it has no facility for either. Neither body will last forever, but the non-physical body will last for very much longer than the physical one and can, if very carefully looked after and given electrical charge of life force every so often, it can be made to last for several thousands of years. That is, if the owner wishes to remain on this structure that long and is in such a position of power that he or she can be given or demand to be given this extra life force charge. Before birth or rebirth, any person who has lived on the rest planes for some time must be taken away and prepared for birth. This means that his or her body on this structure must be extinguished. Remember that the basic entity or soul, which is man or woman, has no body and cannot be destroyed in any way, and must be carefully stored and labelled. It is as simple as that, a computerized label of such complexity that only the very special computers we have here could come to work it out and give the necessary instructions for that particular person's soul's eventual destiny when the suitable parents of the right genealogy are found. Only certain parents can possibly give life to certain children, which is why some people who are of very mixed race are barren. Maybe their bodies appear to work, but they're trying to have a child with somebody, and there's no child that has their genealogy. Remember that the basic entity or soul, which is man or woman, has no body and cannot be destroyed in any way and must be most carefully stored and labelled. Oh, I've said that already. I'll read it again. It's as simple as that. A computerized label of such complexity that only the very special computers we have here could come to work it out and give the necessary instructions for the particular soul's eventual destiny. When the suitable parents of the right genealogy are found, only certain parents can possibly give life to certain children. If abortion takes place after the quickening, then a person who has been most carefully placed in the host mother is destroyed, not just their tiny, still forming physical body, but also the spiritual or after-death body, both of which, as we have said already, are built in some magical way by the soul or entity. So to be clear, the soul of the person is placed into the little embryonic physical body at 12 to 14 weeks, and then it starts to work on the basic little embryo and begins to make the person as like as he or she has been in their previous lives. And this is a very important piece of information which the living must come to know and understand. If the tragic destruction of the unborn child takes place with the person or entity inside the tiny forming body, this can have far-reaching and terrible effects upon the minute, complicated, precious, precious person forming within it, wrenched away from the tiny wrecked mass of his or her forming body. That person may in later life be severely autistic or born with Down syndrome or very deranged, a ruined person, and quite how extensive the damage might be is often undetected, as there is no way that any technician on either structure can be sure of how much damage has been done. What about natural miscarriage? That is different, and nature has a fail-safe mechanism, which means that if the forming child is not up to standard, then the body will not come to full term. We here think that it is dreadfully cruel to force any living creature to live in a hopelessly deformed body from birth. Such people come to terrible suffering, which can often have far-reaching consequences and effects upon them in later life. Thalidomide was one of those. Sometimes not just in one, but in many after such lifetimes. Because we are, our spirits, our characters are formed by the experiences that we have in each life. I nearly omitted the previous paragraph, as I feel that there are many reasons that a person may be born deformed, as further indications will show, and might our interference cause them more harm. It distresses me that women go through amniocentesis and are not given their results till they are 18 weeks pregnant. If the doctors reckon their child has Down syndrome, they are offered an abortion, which is often taken up. However, there have been mistakes made, and in another dictation it says that these children should be allowed to live, and that often they are very loving and bring joy to their families. I think it's a terrible decision for any doctor to make and fraught with problems. Personally, I feel that we should leave it to the powers that be. Dictation continues, no matter how many lifetimes someone lives, he or she will be much the same, rather like an actor who puts on a different costume to play different parts. He may, with different parents, have bad eyesight or a longer nose, be a little taller, have longer or shorter legs, be thinner or fatter. But for those of us who watch the living, you can always see that he or she is the same person returned to life. In some mysterious way, once the entity or seed, which is the living person, is placed inside the living embryo, then the real characteristics which will become the living person begin to be formed by the very entity itself. Therefore, it is possible for the same parents to produce such varying and different children, some looking very different to others, some very much cleverer, even taller, and quite opposed in looks. It's not known exactly how it is that the spiritual entity works on the living flesh, on both structures at once, but it is an extremely delicate and precious process. Any interference with this forming infants, once the soul has been placed in the tiny embryo, and the whole becomes a complete entity, a living person, such interference will cause terrible harm to the possible forming future person. No abortion should ever take place once the quickening has begun. Let all living persons remember that everyone is involved. One lifetime is only one bead in the entire necklace of many, many lives. If abortion is regarded as casually as it is now and allowed to continue at any time before birth, then there will be many millions of those living now who may come to terrible harm in future incarnations. How many childless couples are there now in the Western world who cannot adopt children because there are no children for them to adopt? We know that it will never be possible to have a perfect world, and mistakes will always happen. But we hope in the future that mothers will come to understand the tremendously important work they do in creating life. Without the work of bringing intelligent children into the world, there can be no world. For what is the world without people in it? And what is more, healthy people? But we will speak about health in another chapter. Another thing too, is we've just had two disastrous wars. And a friend of mine, her first little boy, was born with only little tiny deformed fingers on the end of his right elbow. And my sources have said that he was terribly wounded in the First World War. But he is a marvellous boy and tremendously popular. She might, if the doctors had seen that he had this deformed arm, she might have been offered a termination, which would have further destroyed a marvellous young man. Anyway, my comment. Some time ago, a friend came to me and told me an extraordinary story. My friend had been studying neurolinguistic programming and met a woman who offered to perform a regression on her. During this session, she helped her to remember being in her mother's womb before birth. She asked my friend what she could see, and my friend said she was surrounded by red and purple knives and felt an overwhelming feeling of fear. Quite obviously, she was alive and quite well and happily married with a son of her own. What had caused these memories? At a later date, she went to one of her sisters and told her this story. And her sister was able to explain, as she was older and remembered what had happened. Their mother had been married twice. She had two daughters by her first husband, but the marriage was not happy and they parted. Later she married again, this time very happily, and because her second husband had had no children, she agreed to have a child with him. They were both overjoyed when she gave birth to another daughter. However, she was not happy when she found herself having a fourth child. They were living in a Catholic South American country where abortion is illegal, but my friend's mother felt unable to cope with another baby and sought a backstreet abortion. By this time, her pregnancy was well advanced and the process dangerous to both her and the baby. The result was that she hemorrhaged badly and had to be taken to hospital. The doctors probably knew what she had tried to do, but tactfully said nothing. They told her that she was lucky, that she had lost a lot of blood and had an infection, but the baby was safe. My friend was lucky and has lived a very good and useful life, but she could be made to remember that pre-birth fear. How much worse would it be for one of us whose gestation is just beginning and we arrive on the other side, our after-death body barely formed and our precious soul, our entity, so shocked and damaged and frightened that no one can do anything but put us into store before we have to live another or a succession of lives when we have to come back mentally or possibly physically deformed. No woman should ever consider an abortion without she is aware of these facts. She should also realise that abortion is murder of her own child and that very few women come out of it without suffering terrible depressions and damage to their own mental health. And why put yourself through this for a casual encounter with a man who would not stand by you and the child you have created together? These dictations were written back in the 70s, and now nearly 50 years later we have the proof of these warnings in that so many of us are now giving birth to children with different forms of autism and other disabilities. This fate could be imposed on any one of us in the future. Right, that's finished. Good home.